Thanks for inviting me to give a talk. And so my talk is on stochastic Hamiltonians, and it's an interesting subject, but I actually do not have a lot of new things to say. So for some of you, maybe this is something you already know, and for some of you, it may be more new. And but I also just like to pose a few questions, and these are questions I think we should try to solve, because you know, stochastic Hamiltonians, they've come a bit to the forefront. I can tell you this term stochastic was we invented at IBM at the lunch table, and we had a student from Colombia who was doing a project with Sergey Bravi and me, and his advisor Joe Traub asked him what he was working on after he finished the project, and he said, well, stochastic complexity. And the advisor said, you mean stochastic complexity, right? So this was a fairly obscure term, and I wasn't sure that was such a good idea to introduce it, but I'm happy to see that it's actually has been effective. Okay, so so stochastic Hamiltonians, I'll give you one definition, but I also like to point out that it's sort of a definition that you can choose, but you can relax this definition. Okay, so you may know the definition. I hope you can read my, I'm also experimenting with a different talk format, so I hope you can read my handwriting. So I have a Hamiltonian on n qubits, say. And there are a bunch of terms. And I say that Hamiltonian is stochastic if there exists a unitary, which is a product unitary, one unitary on every qubit, such that if I rotate the Hamiltonian is real, and it has this feature, or each term is real, and it has this feature that each term has non-positive off-diagonal elements. So the important thing in stochastic definition is that it's actually not something that's so easy to test, because we allow there be these product unitaries on every qubit, right? That's just a change of basis. And that's basically where some of the difficulty lies that I maybe like to bring up in my talk, or difficulty. So if we just apply this for a two qubit Hamiltonian, right? So have some sum over terms, I can range over all the polys, identity x, y, and z, and some coefficients a, I, j, then it's very easy to see that that Hamiltonian has properties a and b when there's no y components. Actually, there's no identity y and x, y components. Y, of course, is allowed because that's a real component. But there are constraints like this. So this is then, you know, if I fix a basis, this is the set of conditions for just two qubits. Now, actually, this set of conditions, so if you fix the basis, the Hamiltonian is real. So from the 15 parameters that you have here, you actually obtain 9 parameters. And then this condition implies that you're in some convex set in this 9-dimensional space. Yeah. So that's still pretty big. And perhaps also, if I now say I just have a 2-qubit Hamiltonian, and I now allow some local unitary rotations, and maybe these local unitations, under these local unitations, I will make the thing stochastic, or I'll make it have these properties. It's known that if you can characterize their invariance of Hamiltonians, or 2-qubit Hamiltonians on their local rotations, they're called Maclean invariants, and there are 18 of them. So a point in this 18-dimensional space represents one class of Hamiltonians that are all the same. They're all related to each other by local unitaries. So you, in this 18-dimensional space, you want to somehow see where this class of stochastic Hamiltonians sits. It's actually not such an easy. So I've puzzled on this problem for the last 3 weeks, basically, which is not very long, of course. But it's not so easy. I thought, oh, maybe I just, you know, get some results. And it turns out to be not so easy. And that's just 2 qubits, right? Because if I ask something is stochastic, not just for 2 qubits, but for many qubits, then every term I have to do this rotation and these, you know, there's overlapping things. So I have the common bases in which every term is real and has non-positive off-diagonal elements, which adds additional complexity. Okay, so that's just one comment. But what I want to go back to is, like, what motivates this definition? And perhaps you know this. And you can relax this in various ways. So here I said, I take my Hamiltonian and I allow some product of local unitaries. And under, if I do that, my Hamiltonian has to be real and has these non-positive off-diagonal elements. But you can actually relax this and say, okay, I take my n qubits and I add some ancillas and I have some constant depth circuit. And maybe the class of Hamiltonians that are that are real and have non-positive off-diagonal elements is larger when I allow this freedom than when I allow this freedom. This has not been explored at all. Maybe it's not a good idea, but I think it's also just fairly unexplored. But then you can ask, well, why do you have such a freedom? So I want to go back to, you know, what motivates the stochastic definition. And essentially, you could say that it all relates to the partition function. I think that's the nicest way of phrasing it.
It's also been, of course, we know that if you have a Hamiltonian stochastic, there's this local basis rotation, and then it has these features, and then the ground state is a state which has non-negative coefficients in this particular basis. But a little bit more, I think this is sort of a nicer perspective, because it also allows me to say, make another comment. So we take the Hamiltonian, we look at the partition function, and we can say we're interested when this partition function admits a non-negative representation. What I mean by that is maybe what you expect. I can write this partition function as a trace of a bunch of matrices, which depend on beta, and each of them is sparse and non-negative. So as a matrix, it has just non-negative entries. And I should be able to calculate these entries efficiently from H. And the number of them should be polynomial in N. I'm interested in partition functions that can be written that way. Why? Is because then estimating this partition function is amenable to classical Monte Carlo methods, or called quantum Monte Carlo. And of course, if there are other features you can relate it to, but if beta is very large, then the estimation of Z gives me an estimate for the ground state energy. This is maybe not a very good estimate to do it that way. There may be other methods, but actually, in some of the complexity proofs, we do relate the ground state energy to the value of Z beta. So, and therefore, Z beta and the form of it, namely that it has a non-negative representation in case Hamiltonian is stochastic, is essential. So what do I want to say? So now let me show very simply what the stochastic feature has to do with Z beta having a non-negative representation. And this follows from tricks that most people have seen, but I just want to make a small comment about it. But showing these tricks explicitly, you can see there's some kind of relaxation and allowed. So I can write e to the minus beta h. Of course, I can do some, you know, Trotter-Suzuki decomposition for large n, and I write it like this, and then I can insert a complete basis. All right, I can, let's x be the standard original basis, And then, of course, I can do additional rotations here as long as this kind of thing that I insert is the identity. And I expand this in this this basis, x and y. And then you see that this product becomes a product of these types of terms. Right? For each hi, I have something like this, and there's some arbitrary x and y, and these v's are in there. And so if n is large, I write it this way. And then you can clearly see that if hi is stochastic, meaning that under this basis rotation, it has this feature of having non-positive off-diagonal elements, that that implies that this is non-negative, right? Because of this minus sign here. That's basically the fact that, you know, if you come upon this first non-positive off-diagonal ones, why that's the condition, that really comes from this feature. And so what it implies is that this matrix, if this rotation, is a non-negative matrix for all beta. Right? Because for any beta, I can do this for very large n, and then I write it this way. So that immediately actually brings a small question. So let's say I have e to the minus beta h could, for example, be a non-negative matrix for some beta. Yeah, so if beta goes to infinity, the temperature is very low. But let's say it's a non-negative matrix for some small beta. Yeah. Then I say, well, actually, does that imply that h needs to be stochastic? It doesn't apply that. I can construct numerically very easily an example where in the basis that I'm working in, h will have both positive and negative eigenvalues. In order to know whether it's stochastic or not, I have to play with the unitaries. I have to see if there's another basis under which it would be stochastic. But I expect that not to be the case, and I could potentially work this out. Okay, so what this says is that, so it could be that this is a non-negative matrix for some beta, but it doesn't imply that this quantity that I can, this h that I find this way, is stochastic. Right? So actually, the stochastic condition says that even for beta very large, actually, if this is non-negative for very large beta, then h is stochastic. Right? So it's the most stringent condition. If I ask, instead of defining Hamiltonian stochastic, I ask just about the non-negativity of this matrix. If I ask this to be non-negative for very large beta, if I ask it to be non-negative for very small beta, I get that h is stochastic. I find this somewhat interesting because it says that it may be the case that sometimes you could do a quantum Monte Carlo simulations even if h is not stochastic, but you only do it for temperatures that are lower than some value. Right? So I also want to say that this, you know, we introduced this word stochastic, but of course this is that goes under other names in the physics community, the computational physics community. This is well known and well studied in various ways to explore, you know, to how tricks to avoid the sign problem, right? This is also, yeah. Okay, so now let me say a few more things about this problem on qubits. So I thought, well, you know, two qubit Hamiltonians, I should be able to maybe say something about when the Hamiltonian is stochastic. Now, of course, like I said, it depends. I have a sum of terms, and I have n qubit sum of terms. So, if I can make one term stochastic, doesn't mean I can make them all stochastic in the same basis simultaneously. So, that's a little bit hard. So, I could, but if you restrict yourself to what are bipartite interaction graphs, you can make it a little bit simpler, and you may also be familiar with that, where you say, I can color the vertices of the graph in two colors, and there are only edges between the two colors. And now I'm assuming, so I'm only making some statements when the Hamiltonian for every edge is the same. So that's H with these two colors is the same for every edge. And it's of some form, which could include some one local terms, some fields on the two spins, or it includes a two local part. Then it's very fairly straightforward to show that, so under these conditions for a bipartite interaction graph, and let's say there are no one local terms, so only two locals. So you see here ij ranges over x, y, and z. Then this Hamiltonian is stochastic. And this just follows from doing a unitary rotation that brings this, which is a singular value decomposition, that brings it in diagonal form with these factors to be non-negative first. And then there's some additional freedoms that you can use to change some z's and x's around such that you obey this property. And you can also flip these signs and so on. Okay, so there's not too much to it. Okay, so if I have no local fields and every term on this edge is the same, the graph is bipartite, it's stochastic. You can also show that if, again, bipartite interaction graph, because in those cases it kind of reduces to just a two-qubit case, right, which makes life simple. But if I have local terms and the two local part, which is this part, has only zero or one non-zero singular values, then it's also stochastic. So it's like, you know, XX plus some two local part, and the graph is bipartite and all the interactions are the same. For two or three non-singular values, the situation is quite a bit more complex. But I do believe it can be mapped out, at least in this case. So I think you can, in principle, map out this whole two-qubit case. And I'm actually not, maybe somebody can inform me, but I'm not aware that this is written down somewhere, which actually would be useful to have, I think. Okay. But say, so I'd now like to talk a little bit about these sort of relaxations or more general things. And I just want to refer to some work, I think, which is interested in this respect, by Montanaro, Cubitt, and Pittock on what they call universal quantum Hamiltonians. So they talk about something called an encoding. So you have a Hamiltonian H, and I want to encode it. And for this case of stochastic, or for the case of the partition function having a non-negative representation, I'd like to encode my Hamiltonian H into a new Hamiltonian H prime, which is real and has non-positive off-diagonal elements. An example of such an encoding is just doing local, you know, product unitaries. Okay. But more generally, they actually prove that there's, and this encoding idea kind of extends perturbation gadgets in some ways. It's a very general concept. But they've shown that any encoding which obeys some nice properties can be written as something like this. I take my H tensor, some projector P plus H star, the complex conjugate tensor Q, and then I allow Vs, which are isometries, but which are product isometries acting on all the Q bits or Q dits of my system originally. And these projectors have to sum up their identity. And you can show that if you have that encoding, then the partition function Z prime of H prime is related to Z by some constant. So if I know if there's an efficient way of or if there's a non-negative representation of this, I'm good for that. And this is one definition they give, and they have a more relaxed definition, which includes approximate simulation. So with errors, right, you're not reproducing this partition function exactly with this constant, and also that you simulate or you encode, represent H below some energy cutoff. Right, so you may only be interested in capturing the features of your Hamiltonian below some energy cutoff. Okay, so let me give you an example. So there's a fairly, there's a very old trick in the quantum information textbooks. Well, I don't know if it's in the textbooks, which is you can do a real, right? You don't need to use, in gates, you don't need to use complex gate. You can do everything with real gates. And also with Hamiltonians, I can take my Hamiltonian H, and now I take an example of this mapping, which is very simple. I take the eigenstates of the poly Y operator. These are the two eigenstates. And I define H prime. And you can check that if you take the complex conjugate of H prime, it's itself. So this is a real Hamiltonian. So in fact, I can represent every Hamiltonian by a real Hamiltonian, as is well known. And in their paper, they actually also give some tricks. You know, this Ancilla qubit is tensored with every term, so it's not very local. So there are also tricks to preserve the locality of the Hamiltonian that I give with a little bit more overhead. Now, if you go, just a comment, if you go back to this thing about I want to determine when a Hamiltonian is stochastic, so I say the Hamiltonian has to be real, then of course I can say, well, I can always map it onto a real Hamiltonian with this trick. But of course you have to note that I had two qubit terms perhaps in my original problem. Now I have, three qubit terms. So I haven't necessarily made the problem of deciding when it's stochastic much easier. Because I have to now say, okay, I got real, three qubit, Hamiltonian with three qubit terms. When does this have this non-positive off-diagonal elements? When can I do a further rotation on this? And two qubit terms are kind of, there's some more math known about this. So the other thing is that so this encoding idea kind of generalizes perturbative gadgets. So the idea of Bravi-Hastings have shown that any stochastic Hamiltonian can be mapped onto the transverse field Ising model, right? So which is sort of good news for D-Wave in some sense, anything stochastic you ever want to do, you can kind of map it via a lot of gadgets, so it's not very efficient in practice, to a transverse field Ising model. But this is an example of something where the, it's not just you use these gadgets instead of some, local unitaries to map one Hamiltonian and another. So it's an example of trying to, so I could say, well, I'm only interested in if I have a Hamiltonian that I start with and I can map it onto something stochastic by, yes? Oh, okay, so I have to. Then I call it stochastic, right? I don't know, we introduce this notion of stochastic and now we're stuck with the definition. Okay, so let me say one thing about complexity theory. Let me just, so we've worked a lot on trying to, so we started by wanting to prove that D-Wave was classically simulatable. That's our motivation. And we didn't ever prove this, right? So this is partially good news because it shows maybe there's something interesting going on. We did prove that if you have a stochastic Hamiltonian, if you do adiabatic computation with stochastic Hamiltonian and the Hamiltonian is frustration free, you can efficiently simulate it. That is a result by Sergey Bravi and me. But we also wanted to have a circuit model in representation of stochastic computation, right? So like, okay, stochastic adiabatic computation, maybe there's a circuit model that captures this. We have made various attempts and then Sergey had some good ideas, and then it turned out that circuit model was just classical computation. So it's actually not so easy to come up with this. And so then we moved also to this complexity theory, because there we could prove stuff. And what we could prove is saying that, okay, the problem is, what is it saying? Okay, so there are these classes, NPs, hard optimization, classical optimization problems. MA is just a relaxation where you allow a little bit of error. In the proof, and the we defined this class stochastic MA, and a problem that stochastic MA completes is determine the ground state energy of the transverse field Ising model.
First, it was a general stochastic Hamiltonian. Then, with these gadgets I just showed in the mentioned in the previous slide, it's the ground state energy of the transfer fieldizing model. In general, of course, QMA complete is the ground state energy of a Heisenberg model. So this Pittock paper also gives the latest results on this. And in some sense, so what I want to point out with this diagram is that there is this NP, and that is, you know, there's around is a stochastic MA, and we proved that stochastic MA is in AM. Now, you may have not heard about AM, because it's also a classical proof system with a prover and a verifier, but actually the verifier starts with sending some random bits to the prover to sort of challenge him, and then the prover gets back with an answer, and then the verifier does some computation. Whereas in usual MP, you know, the verifier receives input from the prover. But the point is that it's actually believed under de-randomization that AM is equal to NP, and so this whole thing, so and it drags stochastic MA with it. Which means at this level of computational problems that whether you're looking at the ground state energy of the transverse fieldizing model or of the ground state energy of a classical spin model, which is frustrated, it has the same complexity, or that's what it would say, right? And so the thing is that, so what we believe is that real quantum problems kind of, you know, they're not in NP. Right, they stick out a little bit. So this is BQP. And so BQP complete problems, we believe, are not in NP. And also QMA is sort of, you know, not in AM. So there's something, and that's, you know, it's really the sine problem. You know, so I've always felt like at physics people say, well, we've got to solve the sine problem. Well, I don't think there's anything to solve. This is where our power comes from. I think that's probably the only power, well, maybe that the quantum computer has is that sine problem. So that's it puts BQP outside of NP, and it makes QMA different from stochastic MA. So okay, that's the point of but the complexity theory doesn't say anything about, you know, if this were all to collapse, then I could simulate my adiabatic quantum computer classically. No, it wouldn't say. And it's still also possible that stochastic, you know, adiabatic computation or quantum annealing could actually provide. I've gotten more convinced. In fact, usually if you can't prove something, it's usually that the fact is it's not true, right? So we tried very hard to prove it, and we weren't able. So anyhow, maybe Elizabeth has something more to say about this. Okay, so one more thing. So I'm actually going a bit too slow. So we also heard, again, going back to this thing about stochastic, and I want to pose a question here. So this is a question that I have not been able to prove, and maybe some other people have ideas. Maybe I should have spent enough time on it. Okay, so usually one of the motivation of doing this stochastic thing is realizing that a quantum mechanical system, like this is, you know, n particles and some kinetic term, potential term, this is stochastic. And you can generalize this to qubits, as to superconducting qubits, where you have charges and fluxes, and this is the kinetic term, and this is the potential term. Yeah? And like we heard in another talk, in order to make something that's non-stochastic, you need to introduce a voltage. Now, this is only a single term, so you need to have multiple qubits. So sort of all of quantum mechanics is stochastic. But this is a high-dimensional system, and what we usually do is that in superconducting qubits, of course, you're not working. You just define your two-level subspaces as part of this very high-dimensional space. And so that one brings the question. So say I have a stochastic Hamiltonian in qdits, or maybe the dimension goes to infinity, and I truncate each qubit to a two-dimensional subspace, which contains the low-energy dynamics, contains the ground state and so on. Call that H-effective. Can H-effective be non-stochastic? That's kind of weird, because I just said, well, there are these classes. Because what it means that, you know, this H effective being non-sequestered can't better not be universal for adiabatic quantum computation or something, because then I would, you know, mix up some of these classes. And in addition, even if it can be non-sequestered, I could still, if this were true, I could still go back to the original H, but then it would have very high dimension. I could go back to this H and simulate that Hamiltonian using that. So this is So this is a bit open, and you have to be careful what you mean. You know, if this is non-stochastic, it still has a non-negative ground state, right? So it has some special features, but I don't even know whether that's true. Now, one thing you can say, which is a very simple observation, if, you know, let's say I start with high-dimensional systems, continuous variables, so one of those variables, like the position, I define a 0 and a 1 as two wave functions, and let's say these wave functions have non-negative coefficients. And originally, my Hamiltonian is stochastic in this basis, and so that's just the position of one particle, maybe there are many particles. Yeah. Then if I do that truncation, so every particle is now truncated into that two-dimensional space, then H effective is stochastic in that basis made from the 0, 1. You can show that. Yeah, but if I allow some other, you know, these coefficients are complex or, you know, they have negative coefficients, I don't know, actually. I can't prove it. So what we have is, another way to summarize this, is we have gadgets that that start with a stochastic Hamiltonian, you know, this is a, and due to perturbation theory, and end up with an effective Hamiltonian, which is stochastic. But we don't know whether there exist gadgets, which we believe to be unlikely, but I'm not sure, I don't think that everybody's proved it, that you start with a stochastic Hamiltonian and you end up with something non-stochastic. Okay, so to sum up, so I'm not sure I've told you that many new things, but maybe I just think there are more open questions here which are of interest to theorists. So we know, of course, that stochastic Hamiltonians are universal for dynamics, you know, excited states, there's nothing special going on there. They're likely to be non-universal for quantum adiabatic computation, but we don't know what the power is, as everybody's been puzzling over. Now, one thing I want to maybe mention is that this algorithm that we wrote down in 2008, which applies to stochastic and frustration-free adiabatic quantum computation, meaning that frustration-free is that the terms, the ground state is such that it's the lowest energy state of all the terms in the Hamiltonian. So that looks restricted, but you can also use it as a heuristic strategy for transverse field Ising models, so to say, where you just take, instead of, like, you know, taking a two-qubit term as a possible term in the algorithm, you take a cluster of maybe log n size, and I can give you the prescription of what the classical algorithm you would run in order to sample from the output distribution. So it's just a heuristic strategy. And if the cluster that you do this on gets large, it should get better. But of course, at some point, it computationally gets too complicated. So that's why we can't prove this for non-frustration-free. Okay, so the last thing is that I'd like to, you know, like I said, more work needs to be done to determine whether Hamiltonian is stochastic, or to understand this boundary between stochastic and non-stochastic Hamiltonians, potentially using, you know, encodings or perturbative gadgets and so on. Okay.
While our next speaker sets up, there's time for a quick question. Maureen?
Thanks, Barbara, for a great presentation. one of the subjects that I've been trying to understand is the stochasticity to try to bridge the divide between, let's say, adiabatic theory and open system quantum annealing. And to the point that Ed was mentioning earlier on with the physical simulations, stochasticity is a comment about, like, you know, being in the ground state of a system. And I know from having talked to Daniel Adar, if the system is getting excited into other states, for instance, right, you're violating stochasticity. So in the limit where beta is not infinitely large or infinitely small, let's say where you'd just be getting random solutions, is there a point where you're starting to include a small number of excited states, and that ability to, let's say, approximate the partition function is, interestingly, non-stochastic?
Well, maybe what I can say is that it bears to this thing about, like, if I'm only dealing with e to the minus beta, right, in this partition function, then e to the minus beta is non-negative, and there's nothing, and that's very particular for stochastic Hamiltonians. And so that allows the quantum Monte Carlo. So it's not, I mean, what I mean to say is that it's not just a property of the ground state, it's a property of e to the minus beta, yeah? But I agree that if you allow for, because this stochastic Hamiltonian on universal dynamics, if you allow for non-equilibration phenomena and excited levels, there's a lot of things. You know, it's also been proved by somebody that if your ground state energy of an excited state, I think that determining that, well, okay, stochastic Hamiltonian, but the ground state, the energy of an excited state, that problem is QMA complete. So in the excited state manifold, there's indeed a lot of potential for power, but you know, you expect you're working at some temperature, right? So you expect these effects to not be dominant. I mean, even though you're not in equilibrium, you're driven to, you tend to be driven to equilibrium, no? Or what? Well, I don't know. Question. Yeah, of course, this is an experimental question in some sense, right? To what extent? Yeah.
Okay. Let's thank Barbara again.